Good morning, everyone. This is Rock Our World with the last episode, the last video before the Feast of Weeks. This is one of the less known feasts of the Lord, and our Lord is Yeshua, the one Christians call Jesus. They're his feasts. There's a lot of things that have been taught to the Christian church that are inaccurate. They're misinformation. And we've come to the point in history now where God is restoring many, many things. And one of the avenues to come to understand the mystery of God, is what he calls it, is to be obedient. So when you research scripture and you find instructions concerning anything and everything, and then you go ahead and do it, that is the first step in coming to understand the mysteries of God. There's a number of tools that God has given us. Researching scripture definitely is one of them. That's an ingredient you can't go without. And there's fasting, and there's prayer, and there's learning to hear the voice of God, and there's becoming filled with the Holy Spirit. All these are important ingredients, and they're important tools in coming to understand the full plan of God and our place in it and how the plan unfolds. And right now, we're just a few days, a week and a half away from the Feast of Weeks. Now, many believers know this as Pentecost, and they've been told all kinds of stuff about it. But very few have realized and been taught that this is not Pentecost. This is Shavuot. That was written in the original Aramaic. It's a Hebrew word that means weeks. It's the Feast of Weeks. And the reason it's called that is because you count out 7 weeks from a certain starting point. And in the course of your studies, I've been teaching this, I'm going to call it a fact, that both the Christian and Jewish churches removed the books of Enoch and Jubilees from the record of God's word because it disagreed with what they were teaching. It pointed out the error in their teaching. So rather than correct their doctrines and their teaching, they removed those 2 books from God's word. But they are part of God's word. And both of them state this fact, that you cannot use the moon to find the months of the year, because you end up 10 days short. It just states that. You can't use it. So what do the Jewish people do? They use the moon, just like they were told not to. So rather than correct their error, they got rid of the book. The books of Jubilees and Enoch. Now, Christians, on the other hand, don't even give that a shot. They just use the good old Babylonian calendar, which is 100% man-made. And they just sat down, sat down in a room and discussed the matter and say, this is what we're going to do. They didn't ask God. They just said, this is what we're going to do. We're going to peg this day on the Babylonian calendar as this thing and that thing and so on. And they don't even use God's terminology. We're going to, instead of calling the Passover and the days of unleavened bread, they just say, we'll call that Easter, which is the name of a demon. And instead of picking the right day for what they call Pentecost, which is, as I said, is the Feast of Weeks, they just came up with some formula, and I'm not sure that all the churches even follow the same formula. They just make stuff up, and they teach their people the things they made up. So, and none of this is led by the Holy Spirit. So, we all have the avenue to research Scripture. We have the tools provided for us. We have our Master Yeshua, who told us that he had to go, but he would send us the Holy Spirit, and it would teach us everything, and it would bring to mind the things that he taught while he was here amongst us. Okay, so I'm going to just give a brief overview or brief set of instructions of how you find the correct day for the Feast of Weeks. And first, I'm going to encourage anyone and everyone to read the commentary from my last video. I just finished it this morning. So that's a good starting point for this video. Read the last commentary. This could very well be the last, this could be the last video that I ever make. Could be. This could be the last week and a half before Yeshua comes to find his bride ready and waiting, and he will empower her with the greatest infilling of the Holy Spirit that's ever been witnessed and experienced, as it teaches us in the book of Joel. So make sure you read the book of Joel, read about the army of God. That's what the bride will become immediately, as soon as she's empowered. She will become the army of God, and she will shine an intensely brilliant light into the gross darkness that's growing upon the earth. And she will bring the good news of the kingdom. And she will present 100% truth instead of this mixture of truth and error that we have been immersed in these many hundreds of years. So, back to I'll do a brief explanation of how you find the Feast of Weeks, and you piece together what's written in Leviticus, in Deuteronomy, in Numbers. You read the three testimonies of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, piece together that last few days before Yeshua was crucified, exactly on the right day, that is the 14th day of the first month, which is the Passover, which begs the question, how do we find the 14th day of the first month when our present record of God's word doesn't explain the calendar anywhere? We're just taking the Christians' word for it, that they got it right, and we're just taking the Jewish people's word, which that it's right, without any proof. And neither of them agree with each other. So, what we find, and we need Jubilees 6. That's the most complete explanation of the Feast of Weeks. Now, before I forget this, we have the first record in God's Word, I'm going to call it, of someone keeping the Feast of Weeks in the book of Jasher. And this was a long time before Mount Sinai, before Mount Horeb, when God gave the commandments to Moses, as he was leading the Israelites out of Egypt. So backing that story up, a few hundred years in the book of Jasher, we see Jacob when he was on his way to Egypt, following the rest of his family. He was the last one to get there. He was very reluctant to go to Egypt. And as he journeyed there, he stopped on the Feast of Weeks and he celebrated that festival before his God. And he didn't have any new grain because they were in the midst of a severe famine. So he had old grain with him, and that's what he used to celebrate the feast of Firstfruits. And that's the beginning point of the Feast of Weeks. Anyway, the point of that is God's festivals were established at the foundation of the world. Very likely, God taught Adam and Eve about his festivals. He very likely taught Enoch and Noah and Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. All of God's servants knew about the festivals of God because they were established from the foundation of the world. God made his plan before he made Adam and Eve. Okay, back to finding the stay. You piece all those bits of all those parts of the instructions together, and you find that that the Feast of Firstfruits is the name of this complete festival, and the Feast of Weeks is the final day of it. So what we end up with is a 51-day exercise. We're instructed, once you put all these pieces together, we're instructed to find the first Sabbath that occurs after the Passover. And if you go back to my last grouping of videos, I covered this, bits and pieces of this, a number of times. But I'll start with this. How do you find the Sabbath day? See, our God told us he wants us to obey him. And he told us that he wants us, in amongst all those instructions he's given us, he wants us to keep his Sabbath day. That's probably told to us more times. When you read all the scripture, it's told to us more times than any other instruction. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. But it doesn't minimize that there's a lot of things God asks us to do, that we need to be on a road where we're putting more and more of his instructions into our lives and correcting ourselves. So, for example, our God asks us to remember the widows in their affliction. Help them where we can. Remember the fatherless in their affliction, not just orphans, that's translated that way sometimes, but to be without a father is a very common situation, and it always has been, where fathers abandon their families completely or often emotionally. Remember the fatherless. They have a particularly difficult struggle. Young men in particular, and young ladies that have been abandoned in some way by the father. And another one that God says, remember the stranger. That is a foreigner, somebody who comes new to your country and is lost in ways we can't imagine if we've never done that, where we leave our home, our family, our culture, and all of a sudden we're immersed in something completely foreign to us. So, those are three more of God's commandments. So now let's get back to the Sabbath. How do we know when the Sabbath is? Why would God tell us over and over and over, remember the Sabbath day, not any Sabbath day, but the Sabbath day? God already made it holy. We're to keep it holy. How do you find it? Okay, so this is a little bit of my testimony. This goes back 16 years now. I was looking for the New Moon Festival, and I ran into God had me run into a guy that told me he kept the Sabbath in a different way. I wasn't looking for the Sabbath. I was looking for the New Moon Festival. And I was bugging God about it because nobody wanted to pay attention to the New Moon Festival, which is the next one on the list. Sabbath days first, the New Moon Festival second, and then we have 8 yearly Moedim. So now that there are 10 Moedim. The Sabbath is the first one, the New Moon Festival is the second one, and then we have these 8 yearly Moedim, and then there's one more. That's why I say there's 11 appointed times. I'll try and get to that in this, what I'm trying to accomplish here today. This would be called my last attempt, my hope that I can encourage some people out there, or many people, to become involved in the keeping of God's appointed times so that wisdom and understanding come to us. That's the only way it happens. God does not give wisdom and understanding to those who are disobedient. We can't understand the mysteries of God if we're just religious. If we just go to church or the synagogue and listen to the stuff that's taught there, that's not the avenue through which we come into understanding of God's mysteries, His plan. Okay, back to the Sabbath. So, God had me run into this guy that said, I keep the Sabbath a different way. I find the Sabbath using the moon. I had never heard of such a thing. But I'm wired just this certain way. And I'm sure I'm wired this way because God made me this way. But most people just run away screaming if they hear something off the wall that doesn't match their religious paradigm or any paradigm. I want to know what this guy's talking about. And he didn't explain himself. He just gave me that information that, yeah, he didn't want it to be a surprise somewhere further down the road in our possible relationship. So I immediately asked my wife to go on the internet. I was not familiar with the internet at all. And she quickly found all kinds of information about what we pulled a name out of the hat, a lunar Sabbath. That's not what it is. It is the Sabbath. That's what we're looking for. We're looking for God's Sabbath. So in this research, I was out on the road doing a job, but my job got shut down for most of summer. All of a sudden I had all kinds of time to research this matter. So with my wife's help, we found whatever information was available on the internet, and it kept pointing us to the book of Enoch. So I asked my wife to help me to get us a book. It arrived in about a week, and I don't think I had been reading 2 days when I found the calendars of God, I call them. They're not just one calendar, there's 2 calendars. And in the middle of all this that I was doing, I was being challenged to research the word 4150. And the Hebrew word 4150 in the Strong's Concordance doesn't mean what most translations, beginning with the King James. The old King James did not know what this word meant. They translated it, I'm going to say, with about 10 different words, and that it does not mean 10 different things. So I'll fast forward this this testimony, and I eventually found that the JPS, the Jewish Publication Society, is the most accurate translation from Hebrew of the Torah, prophets, and writings. So I highly recommend you get that translation, but it translates this word correctly all the time. It means appointed time. And in Hebrew, it sounds something like this: Moedim, it's plural, and Moed, it's singular. And when about this time this was happening, we were kind of in the middle of being part of the Messianic movement, and they taught incorrectly that the Moedim referred only to the yearly festivals. So in this research I was doing at my kitchen table 16 years ago, I identified this word, and I hit with my wife's help. We had a pretty good Bible study computer program, and she quickly printed out the 200 uses of this word on a stack of paper. And I had been searching for it. The scripture I wanted was, it turned out to be Ezekiel 45:17. But that's the avenue that it came to me on. I got my wife's help. I'd been searching through my big old Strong's Concordance, and it was very labor-intensive, and the computer made it much simpler. Ezekiel 45:17 says this. It says, "These are my Moedim. These are my appointed times. The Lord says, the Sabbath day, the new moon festival, and then the yearly appointed times, of which there are 8 of them." So we have 10, and we have that 11th one I hope to get to. So there I was. I wasn't looking for the Sabbath day. I was looking for the new moon festival. But God needed to show me that, in fact, they work together there, and I could see that everywhere the new moon festival was talked about, almost all the time God talked about the Sabbath day also. So then in the study I was doing these many years ago, I quickly find Ezekiel 46:1, which says the eastern gate of the temple, and this is looking forward to the 1,000-year kingdom. The eastern gate of the temple will be closed on the 6 working days, but open on both the Sabbath and the new moon festival. So in other words, there were 3 components of time, not just 2. Not just 6 working days and a Sabbath day. 6 working days and a Sabbath day. That's what a week is. 6 working days and a Sabbath. This new moon festival fits in there somewhere. So to speed this process up, I've got Enoch chapter 72-80, which explains all the signs from the sun and the moon. The first use of this word, Moed, is found in Genesis 1:14, the 14th verse of our record of God's word. And I'm going to remind you that why would God give us exact days for his appointed times, but not tell us how to find them? Why would we just have to trust the Jewish people that they had it right, when in fact they've been lying all along? And so have the Christians. So, Genesis 1:14 says that the sun and the moon were put in place, the sun, the moon, and the stars were put in place to give signs for the appointed times. So in other words, all the appointed times have to have a sign. And the Sabbath is the very first one of the appointed times. And again, God says over and over and over, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. So it boils down to that Sunday cannot be the Sabbath day, and Saturday cannot be the Sabbath day, nor any of the other days of the week can be the Sabbath day, because they have no sign. Nothing in the Babylonian calendar has a sign, and both Christians and Jews have chosen to use the Babylonian calendar to find the Sabbath day. So they're both wrong. Anyway, back to my story. In Enoch chapter 72 to 80, God describes all the signs from both the sun and the moon. And as far as the stars go, you just got to look up in the sky. And I didn't really know that much about stars until this all started to unfold in front of me. And I've come to see how the stars are connected. And one of them would be very obvious. If you want to Google September 23rd, 2017, there was an amazing sign in the sky, in the stars. And in fact, just the last week, we had a huge solar event. And they're telling us this is only going to get worse. We're in a cycle with the sun where we're getting bombarded by coronal mass ejections, and at the same time our magnetic field is weakening, heading towards a reversal, which they know has happened. I'm going to say hundreds of times in past history. They can see that from sediment on the seafloor, the direction metallic particles are settled down in the sediment. They can go through all the layers and see that the magnetic field has reversed many, many times. And when it's about to make a reversal, it's very weak. And so these coronal mass ejections, the energy coming from the sun can easily penetrate. And that's the biggest reason we're having amazing northern lights. Anyway, I'm getting down a rabbit trail. So back to the Sabbath day. Just to speed this whole thing up, when Enoch described the signs from the moon, he made it very clear, that it's the sun that tells us where to find the days and the months. Well, actually the seasons first, tells us where to find the four seasons of the year, and then there's 3 months within each season, and then there's the days of the month can all be found very, very readily. You start counting each season the day after either the equinox or the solstice, divides the year into four parts. There's 90 days you count, and then the one day to, now it's progressed to 1 to 4 days that fall between the seasons. You just keep track of them separately, but you can always find. What we need is the first day of the first month and the first day of the seventh month to find all of the appointed times. That's what we of the yearly appointed times. And they're very easy to find. They're the day after the spring equinox is the first day of the first month, and the day after the fall equinox is the first day of the seventh month. From that, we can find yearly appointed times. But this festival that we're celebrating right now, which is called the Feast of Firstfruits, we need both calendars. That's what I call them. One calendar the sun operates, the other one the moon operates. So if you listen to Enoch's description of the moon, he shows very clearly that the moon has been created by God to show its face to us 28 days every cycle. And during that 28 days, there's a distinct sign on the 7th day, the 14th, 21st, and then the 28th. And then after this 28-day showing, the moon goes dark for either 1 day or 2 days. So what we have is 4 weeks every moon cycle that can be seen with your eyes, just like it says in Genesis 1:14 that there has to be a sign from either the sun or the moon. And I'll get to I already mentioned the stars once, but we'll try and get to that 11th appointed time. So now back to the instructions. Okay, now we know how to find the weeks. We watch the moon to find the weeks. So back to the instructions that we find the first Sabbath that occurs after Passover. We already know how to find Passover because it's the 14th day of the first month. It is 14 days after the spring equinox. We found it. Now we're looking for the first Sabbath. So we watch the moon. The moon in this year's case, I've covered this a few times already, but we're going to try and do a complete comprehensive description of the Feast of Weeks, because it is possible that the bride of Yeshua will be identified on the Feast of Weeks. Now, it occurs every year, so it can be this year. We've been warned that it's very, very close by many servants of God. Very, very close. So, back to our Passover this year was April 3rd. The first Sabbath that occurred after the Passover was on the 8th, but we didn't start counting weeks until the 11th because the 10th, because we had a two-day new moon. New moon days are not part of a week. So when you're counting weeks, those days are omitted. The new moon is, just like back to Ezekiel 46:1, is separate. The new moon is separate from the Sabbath day, and it's separate from the six working days. So here we are. We're starting to count Sabbaths. The first Sabbath was completed on the 17th of April, and then the 24th, second one, and then May 1st was the third Sabbath, May 8th was the fourth Sabbath, and then we had a new moon on the 9th. So now Sabbaths are on Thursdays. So we had a Sabbath on the 16th, just this past week, was the first quarter. And it was cloudy here that evening that you look for the sign for the coming Sabbath. So I didn't get to see it, but moon charts can be followed. They're a backup plan. So Sabbath was 16th. Right now, we are the 19th. So we're looking for the second Sabbath of the moon cycle. And it's the day, as Enoch describes this, the day that the moon comes up at the same time as the sun goes down. And once you study the whole matter and watch it for a few months and then a few years and so on, I'm going to say it's within a half an hour of each other, very close to each other. The closest they get, it's called a conjunction. And in this case, it's coming Sabbath day, where the conjunction is on the 22nd. And on the 22nd, the evening of the 22nd, at sunset, the sun right here near Regina, Saskatchewan, is where I live, near just 40 miles southeast of Regina, Saskatchewan. The sun sets at 8:50 and the moon rises at 8:31. They're 19 minutes apart. And the day before and day after, it's long ways off of that. So that's the cheat way to find the day of the conjunction or the second Sabbath of the cycle. But when you can, most of the time, the skies are clear enough, you can see a lot of these signs. So you can keep track of it. I've done this for now 16 years. You can keep track of it all the time. And if the odd time you find you look at the moon and say, oh, I got the wrong day, just change it. God isn't like humans are. See, here we are, we've been comfortable keeping the Sabbath on the wrong day for hundreds of years. There's no sign for Saturday or Sunday or Monday or Tuesday. No signs involved. Has to be a sign. Why wouldn't God do it that way? Why wouldn't he make it easy? So here we have the Sabbath on the 23rd. this Thursday, and then that's the sixth Sabbath. We're counting weeks, remember? The seventh Sabbath is on the 30th of May. The seventh Sabbath. Of course, Sabbaths go from sunset to sunset, so right at sunset on the 30th begins the Feast of Weeks. That's how we're instructed to do it. We count out seven Sabbaths, starting after we've found that first Sabbath that follows the Passover. That, right at sunset, when that first Sabbath is finished, is the Feast of Firstfruits. The whole count is called the Feast of Firstfruits. That's Jubilee 6, explains this. And then we count out seven Sabbaths as, or weeks, 7 weeks, as the moon shows us. And then the day after that count is finished is the Feast of Weeks. So it does sound a little complicated, but you know, it's like everything else. If we had been taught that as a little kid, grown up, it would be as easy as falling off a log, floating in the water. Anyway, I'm just about out of time, so I'll just speed this up a little bit. I want to point out that, as I've done many, many times, that when we count seven sevens and add one day, we're obviously depicting a Jubilee cycle. And that is then the 11th appointed time. The Jubilee cycle of the Great Tribulation. And you'll come to understand this very clearly if you will read the Book of Jubilees, put it together with the whole revelation of what we call our present day record of God's Word. It's missing the Book of Jubilees and missing the Book of Enoch. So we need all this information. Enoch describes how the calendars work. Jubilees explains that this is a complete festival of 50 days, starting the day before, so we could call it a 51-day exercise. We don't include new moon festivals in that count, so there's a lot of details, and I know it sounds complicated if you've never heard of it, any of it before, but if we were taught truth from the beginning of our life, it would be very simple. So, bear this in mind too, that I'm speaking from the perspective of where I live here in Saskatchewan. So the day does change somewhere. So your job is to watch the sun and the moon, and you can calculate these things yourself. You don't need the Christian church to tell you when things are, and you don't need the Jewish church to tell you where things are, because the sun and the moon are right up there for all of us to look at. And that makes sense, doesn't it? And instead of putting our eternal life into the hands of men not led by the Spirit of God. Okay, not sure I covered everything I would have liked to cover, but I could probably talk for hours and hours. But to cap this all off, this festival points us right back to Acts chapter 3. You read from 16 all the way, 17 to 26. And that is the subtitle of this channel. I call it Rock Our World. Keeping believers up to date with what's been restored so far in the restoration of all things. And if you read those chapters, I mean those verses in Acts chapter 3, you'll see that that Peter's explaining to us that Yeshua cannot come back until the time of refreshing, the time of the restoration of all things. God has been restoring truth. Truth we had long ago. He's restoring truth. And our job as believers is to keep up with the restoration of things, not be have that Laodicean mentality of drifting along and going to church or not going to church, just listening or not listening. We have the internet. God's provided us with an avenue to learn all these things. And he looks in our hearts. So it's not about having every tiny detail correct in your theology. It's about having a right heart. So examine those. And Paul, in Acts 3, read from, again, from 17 to 26, you see that Peter is referring to the book of Joel. So read all of the book of Joel. This bride of Yeshua is the army of Joel. So what happened in the book of Acts there a couple of thousand years ago was a prophecy of what's going to happen in the future. And we enact that prophecy every year when we keep this full festival of the Feast of Firstfruits, which culminates in its final day, the Feast of Weeks. And the prophecy indicates that God could pick this day to empower his bride, fill her full of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, so she can do this job that is given to the two witnesses. And that's who the bride is, the two witnesses, the house of Judah, who are the Jewish people, and the house of Israel, who are Christians. So I'm out of time. I will work at a commentary. So my encouragement, we have quite a number of new people in the last few months that have signed up as subscribers. And to go back in 8 years worth of information, some of which I didn't describe very well or had wrong or all kinds of things. So as I learn, I try to keep up with what I'm learning, and hopefully we're all in tune with our Lord. So tune back in to the commentary in a week or as the week unfolds, and please be anticipating keeping this festival, the Feast of Weeks, that's coming up. Prove to yourself one way or another whether what I've described is correct. Prove it out. If you don't have a book of Enoch and a book of Jubilees, get them ordered. Likely Amazon's pretty efficient. Anyway, with all those encouragements, I will see you either next time, or hopefully we'll meet in the kingdom.